Currently, it's indeed defended. So you can see that building is very big and very strong. Also, we go one by one through various aspects that through which symbolism is enforced in architecture. The first one is function. The purpose for which the building is built. This often affects the way in which the building is built. So, we take two examples. Both are museums. The first is the Museum of Modern Art in Stockholm in Sweden. This is the building in question. You can see that it's very understated, very minimalistic. It's actually based on the design of a military building. You can see that the building is very functional and it's accepting of modern art. It shows that modern art is just another art form that came along and that it's an integral part of artistry and there is nothing special about it. But contrast it to the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao in Spain, which was designed by Frank Gehry. So this is the design, it's a very loud, exuberant sort of architecture. And one interesting thing to note that is that both of these enforce cultural stereotypes. So when you think of Sweden, you think very cool, composed people. And when you think of Spain, it's again a more exuberant image that comes to mind. Just to drive the point home, there is this church called the La Sagrada Familia in Barcelona. It's supposed to be the biggest church in the world. This is again inconsistent with the Spanish stereotype, it's rich with symbolism and it has three entrances which denote the three virtues, which are hope, love and faith. And it is 18 spires, you can probably count them. This is symbolic of 12 apostles, 4 evangelists. The one on the side of the Ideal Virgin Mary and the biggest spire of all, it's supposed to denote Jesus Christ. So, this is in contrast to Gothic churches where the structure had an integral part in how the architecture was developed. Gothic churches, you can see, they tended to soar towards the heavens. This was because they were supposed to serve as a bridge between men and God. Another important feature of Gothic churches is that their domes and arches played a very crucial role. The symbolism that these domes had in Gothic churches that has been carried forward into modern commercial buildings as well. The domes, their purpose was to give an imposing figure as to how they contained a lot of volume, and because of this the people were impressed. Here we can see that the dome was very much on top and so that it contained a lot of volume. Another part which influenced architecture was art. So symmetry, it's supposed to connect to emotional harmony. When a building is symmetric, it conveys a feeling of peace and harmony to the observer. This has been followed throughout the world. For instance, this is the Parthenon, which is symmetric, as you can see. Also, probably a more well-known example, the Eiffel Tower, and much closer home, even the Taj Mahal is very symmetric. So, another important feature through which artists expressed was through doors. Ban the doors feature in this presentation because of the symbolism behind the name. They chose the name doors after an Aldous Huxley novel called The Doors of Perception, in which Huxley talks about his experiences with drugs. And as you are aware, the doors are one of the early proponents of psychedelic rock. But coming back to our presentation, the other doors, as in the doors in buildings, they serve as a relationship between the private space that is within the building and the outer public space. Also, how a door was, it was a marker of power and status. In ancient churches, there were three main doors, which also had stained glass buildings. The number three features, because it's important in Christian symbolism, it denotes the Holy Trinity, the Father, Son and the Holy Spirit. So, banks also, they have a very imposing door so that the entrant is intimidated when he's standing in front of the bank. This is not just in the case of real banks, even fictitious banks have this. This is, it's not probably clear, it's Gringotts from Harry Potter, in which also there is a very imposing door which Harry, when he goes through it for the first time, is very intimidated by the sight of Gringotts. And these are three, you can note that it's three stained glass windows in churches, which are symbolic of the Holy Trinity. Okay, this is the culture you said, it's a museum of culture in Stockholm again. So, what's special about it is that the lighting is very special in culture you said. This is because Sweden, as you know, through the windows they have very low light. Even in the daytime, the light is very low. So, the culture you said, because of its glass buildings, it has a very illuminating and almost ghostly sort of halo in the morning. So even people who have no intention of visiting the museum, when they see this stand out from the other buildings, they tend to visit it. So this is how art is expressed through architecture. So this is a genealogy of architecture symbolism through the ages. In antiquity, there are five main kinds of columns. And these columns, the type of columns, they often symbolize what the building stood for. If the columns are very closely spaced, it meant that the building was supposed to be strong. And if it was very slender, it often symbolized grace and beauty. So, this is a sketch of the five Greek ones and even the Egyptian and Roman ones. The same buildings, when it carried over to the Renaissance, it denoted power, wealth, etc. Because in the changing economic scenario, only the rich people were able to afford the classical type of building. And it's interesting to note that the first attempts to shape a building up to portray a particular image started in the Renaissance. So you can see this is the Boursin Bag, one of the early stock markets, and it has the Greek columns which was carried out and carried forward, and it's served to symbolize strength and power, and that this is a building that was here to stay, sort of. When it carried out to the New World, the initial American banks were all very decentralized. They were sort of rebellious against the European banks, and often they looked at the community rather than just the whole American continent. So, but later on it changed. Also, American banks became centralized, and when they became centralized, they also carried forward the very idea of Greek symbolism, and they also carried out the columns. As you can see, this is the first centralized bank of the United States, and here also you can see the composite columns from Greek architecture.
So we are going to see the architecture. How architecture is helpful in communicating the needs of brands to the customers. So what do you guys think when you hear the word bank? What comes into your mind? Anyone?
Money.
Yeah, obviously. What else? Money, obviously. That's true. Then the huge buildings, as you know, then the corporate structure, corporate aesthetics, you know, it's so neat, everything is so arranged, the marbles. So what are the contemporary attitudes? So, yeah, whatever attitudes we have on the banks are like, first thing is money, as you know, and then responsibility and respectability, how much it is respected, because of the huge bank and they have power, and they have power, the respectability and security and corporate aspects. But if you see, the bank should serve three purposes. First, it should actually give stability, to have strength, to have security. These are the three things that are very much important for the bank. And if you consider stability is actually the, you know, how strong the bank is, whether it will be there for many years, whether we can actually invest the bank and keep the money in the bank. And then strength is how strong the financial strength and economic strength, if there is an economic cycle, if there is an economic downturn, will the bank be able to manage the problem? And then security, whether it's safe, because we are putting a lot of money in it, both financial security and physical security. So if you see the structural problems and map it to the dimensions of space, see, first of all, there is the effective spanning space. figure so that the whole bank is formed. And when you see that these values, the three values I told, stability, strength and security, and we map it with the material solution as well as the psychological dimension. Whenever you say stability, if you see it as a physical thing, there is the building which is sturdy and which has a lot of pillars, columns and it's very big and all. And if you consider it in a psychological way, it has to be very strong, long-term endurance, it has to be there at the base. If you see a long building, if you see a big building, we'll know that the bank is going to be there for many years, and actually we can believe the building and we can believe the bank at least for the building. And there is strength, which actually is denoted by the columns, strong pillars, and the thick walls, many materials used to the building, marbles and everything. And it actually denotes the natural strength. And then there is the security. If you consider the security in those days, it is mentioned by the fortress, city walls, and there is no distance between the walls, and the walls of the people inside, people outside are differentiated with each other. So these things actually kind of brings a psychological anxiety. People who are outside the building will think, what is inside, what can we go inside, that anxiety will be there, and people will be, encouraged to go inside. And there is this closed form, which actually draws a connection. And temple form. Temple form is actually when we go to the man, we can't go to the wall, it's like the main manager directly. That will be public veranda, public place where customers can come. Then there will be private place where the managers will be there, other important customers will be there, and there will be walls. So this is like a layer structure. So one can't enter it so easily. Like temple also, in the outside it will be a common place, and as you go in, you will see the wall and the place. So it's like that temple-like ritual kind of feeling is there. And these stability, strength and security are three things which are there from the beginning. And what is contemporary, what is present is me. Because people actually, as you told, people are not ready to wait for the long queues. And people need a quick transaction. And that's how the internet banking are not going. If you see this, what are the current concerns? In the previous era, in the previous 1990s, as Prashant told, banks had these big buildings because obviously attracted customers to their buildings, rooms, glasses, everything. But what will they do now? Customers, they are not coming to banks, they are actually using the internet browsing and everything. So how to, how to attract customers using this glasses? If you consider that, we have this brand building. How do you think of that? And do you think because of this, because of the improvements in the technology, have the architecture has become sleeker, do people prefer actually, thin buildings with, very normal architecture for banks, still banks have good architecture and stuff. And also, classism is actually compared with colonialism. Because in those days, these pillars, these everything were used by kings and big corporations. So that is considered as colonialism. But nowadays people are not still using people are using this architecture. Because they are not considering them as colonialism, but actually as a high level authority, or it is seen as it has an aura which actually people look at. And if you see the symbols of time and space, there is time. Which actually there is a time component which has three dimensions. Compare a two-dimensional thing and a three-dimensional. The three-dimensional picture has a temporal window, the temporal dimension, which actually if you see a picture from this way and if you see a picture from this way, the view will differ because it's a three-dimensional. So it has that temporal time dimension to the thing. So the time of time, the symbol of time is shown by longevity, history, traditional tradition. These things actually show time. If you tell us history, it obviously means time. And space, we already saw the stability as well. So we are actually having the symbols of time and symbols of space. Symbols of space is already there and symbols of time actually came now. And we are integrating it and putting as a new niche, which is actually used in the marketing communication in the digital age, which is marketing campaigns and advertisements. And if you consider the brand power, still people prefer for branded things and banks which have been brand names. During the 2000 crisis, there were many banks, but the banks which had a good brand names stayed. So we consider the abstracted architecture formed in contemporary campaigns. Let's look at Merrill Lynch. So Merrill Lynch had this ad in the 1990s that they had this amphitheater like this. There was amphitheater and there were four columns. Columns means they know that floating, actually they are not fixed. These are different things which are attached to the image so that they actually bring that specific classism into the classic architecture into the system. And they had these four columns and there was a podium here which was sleek. And they wanted to show the classism in the picture because it's for an image building campaign during the. I don't actually couldn't find the image, so from the explanation they gave, I guess this is the picture. So, if you see, there are some combinations here. If you see amphitheater, columns, and podium. The podium is the center. The podium is actually used in the amphitheater because the speaker will be there. It's not like a generic forum. The speaker will be there and he will be addressing the people. And generally, it is used for rhetoric competitions and all that. People kind of stand in the front and they kind of speak to the audience. So, it is not the, capitalism or everyone, black people have a general right to speak. It's not that they are people. One person has the power and he's addressing the audience. And then there is columns which actually represents the old classism, it's a typical classism architecture. And then there is amphitheater, which is for, that is also a classism architecture because it was small, it was used in those days. So these two things actually represent classism. But this thing, that's right, it is a sleek one. It is a sleek one, and also actually there is one thing. There is a, in the ad, this is mentioned, and in the left it is written, we believe the vibrant marketplace of ideas will make a difference in the critical challenges of the day, in addressing the critical challenges of the day. So from the quote, what they are saying is, they are going to, give a chance to a lot of people and they are going to have a bigger marketplace that everyone can bring in their own ideas. If you consider classism, if you consider this amphitheater, if you consider this podium, or this modernism, that actually is not supporting the idea they are mentioning. And the podium is actually a sleeker one and the sleeker ones are actually not the old ones. Sleeker ones actually came nowadays. So it actually, it's not representing a old age. Even though podium represents old age, the sleeker one represents the new age. So they kind of confuse it with old age and new age, and the theme is also not resonating with the image they have portrayed. It kind of confuses. And also Merrill Lynch always wanted to, their business is always about ideas also. And generally this amphitheater, these podiums were used by these wealthy people. Also they wanted to show kind of agora. Agora is the marketplace of the marketplace where people kind of speak with each other and people kind of tell their opinions, which is represented by this. So this agora, this image, the brand idea, everything doesn't match. It gets confused actually. And so this is the, even though they have tried to use classism, they have not used it completely. In they should understood it better and use it. And then there is Boston Bay Bank, which is actually, it also kind of mixed classism with a new era when the internet came. They used a door, which is a big door used in the classism area, classism era. It is a portrait door and there was a lady sitting in there near the door. This is a door. This is also a basin. So there is a big door which is actually decorated and all because it's a good there was a lady here. There is a lady here and this door is closed. So this also also there. And then there is chase bands and many other things which are used. This is a compound ad. That one is a compound ad. You know, this is a column. This is a column. And they have gates growing. And this is a perfume. And this is the shape of the column. There are some other ads which are doing this. And if you consider, there is, if you consider the modern era, there are ATM cards now. And these ATM cards are also, they are also using architectural buildings in their ATM cards. So it is the central bank of India, and you might have to have it in our headquarters in their buildings and these things. And this one is the Bank of China's ATM card, and it has this great order. And also Sweden, which is actually kind of highly computerized, it has in its ATM machine, it's and we know this, even it has offline, online banking, online, everything. This is the website of JP Morgan Chase. So we'll give you silver. And this is the Bank of India, this is its headquarters. And the logos which have their buildings. Either they use their own headquarters buildings or they use the whichever is famous in their own city, whichever they are famous for. This. And reports, even reports use this. I just really use specifically for it. Actually, meant for global branding. It uses the headquarters of all its branches. And during marketing campaigns, also this company uses their own buildings, headquarters for things. And this is the back also. So the new era has shifted from, you know, from building to marketing message. Money, as you know, it gives a pressure. In the beginning, people are holding the money and they are having that pressure. But now, what happens is everything is transacted. Who are online, and you know, everything has distanced, so it has become an end more than a means. And man always enters this aura, and now also with the ATM cards and websites, portals, and marketing campaigns, it's getting around. So the main message is, you know, symbols matter, and whatever these symbols actually they are communicating, you can't communicate with any other thing. You can't communicate a column, what is column represents, what is symbol. You can't communicate it with the words, and even if you communicate it, it would be effective.
I promise I'll keep it up. So, apparently it's been found out that a lot of people from the IT industry have been putting their jobs to MBAs. Then people try to find out the reason. They found out that it was, they didn't want to do a boring desk job anymore. So they hired a consultant to find to solve this. And the Sweet Smart consultant came up with this idea of making the boring desk interesting instead of making the boring job interesting. So, well, this is the form of this thing. The managerial function that we've chosen are the design that is happening around cubicles and in a lot of workplaces around the world. So this is one of the examples of a design that has been implemented recently in a lot of companies. This is the standard 8x8 cubicle, which has been made a lot more luxurious, and the door has been put very low, simply because and small, because to allow the user for user privacy. So these are the cubicles that are there in the Zurich office of Google. So when the company that did the designing of these cubicles was hired, it spent a good 3 months interacting with each and every employee of Google Zurich to find out what they want out of this, because it is these employees that are going to use these cubicles, and they wanted the interactions to be at its peak. These are the office designs of an architecture company in Europe, the company is in the middle of a forest, and half of it is glass, so that you know the they can use a lot less energy than what it's supposed to be, and it can be a lot more scenic, and you get the feeling of working amongst nature and not missing the outside environment, although you work for long hours. These are again cubicles of Pixar office in United States. There have been a lot of designs in these offices, and we'll discuss more about it soon. This is one more. Basically, this one has a semi-transparent look, so that you know you don't miss. So you have the feeling of both being your office being private and you having a touch of the environment around you. So basically, what we needed to do was come up with our own framework. So when we look at these cubicles, all we see is like some different design just to make it more comfortable. Whereas, like I explained, they have a deeper meaning that the companies or the designers are trying to achieve. So to bridge this gap, we have come up with some design of this kind. So every cultural system, in every cultural system, the knowledge manifests itself in like four ways: symbols, heroes, rituals, and values. So values are those beliefs or those rules that guide us through specific situations. Although the result of these values might not be immediate, but it will be a long-lasting or sustainable and enduring one. Heroes are those people who are alive, dead, real or imaginary, but who have the qualities that are prized by this culture, who are respected by this culture. And rituals are those phenomena that happen in like a that those are a series of actions which repeat themselves in this culture continuously. Symbols are objects that are identified by this culture. Now if you see, values is central to all of these four manifestations, because heroes are considered as a embodiment of these values, and rituals are those which actually convert objects into these symbols of cultural value in this culture, and symbols depict the values that are there in this culture. So what we thought was, instead of looking at the symbols and trying to establish the content of the architecture, if you look at the values and that are derived from these three symbols, heroes, and rituals, we would be able to make a better sense of what the architecture was. For example, if you look here, the value that they're trying to put in is privacy. So, which is important for this culture and this work environment, and that is the reason they have developed this cubicle. So, instead of looking at the cubicle as is and trying to define it, if we look at what are the values of that organization. Here again, the interactions between, so since this is Google and you have a lot of programmers around, it is necessary that they interact offline, because otherwise a lot of knowledge transfer does not happen between these two. So that is, since the interaction is the key, it is important that the organization is shaped this way, like a more open culture and a less private one. Here again, since this is an architecture company, saving resources and is like one of the key values that companies build themselves on. Here, that could be the reason that they have gone with an architecture like this. So, this is the atrium of the picture. I'll I was talking about the picture of this, so I'll just briefly explain it. And these are the steel beams. These steel beams have been riveted and not welded. The reason being aesthetics. And this is the picture inside insignia. So there are two kinds of cubicle. So this is the cubicle. So when you go and sit in, when if you want to think, you know, in a bounded space, like if you have boundaries and you have to think between those boundaries, that is when you go here. Otherwise, you go here and work when you want your thoughts to run wild and just let your thoughts flow. So these are basically the values that Steve Jobs had. So in the entire campus, there was only one restroom because he wanted people to interact. So everyone who wants to use the restroom had to come down there. So there would be a lot of people and a lot of interactions could happen. And the steel beams were custom bolted and not welded. There was a firm in Arkansas that was hired especially for this purpose. Initially, they were also planning to, you know, put a picture symbol on this to showcase their, but due to cost later, they dropped that idea. And a lot of picture characters have been seen around the campus to, you know, reinforce the idea of the picture community. So again, like I said, there are separate rooms that have been provided to promote bounded and unbounded creativity, which could influence the performance of the employees as well.